You're watching a series called Light in the Darkness, a journey through the Gospel of John from the Axis Church in downtown Nashville. For more information and resources, visit theaxischurch.org.
You can be seated. Thank you, Pastor Derek. Welcome and good morning. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors here at the Axis Church, and I'm glad that you're with us this morning. Go ahead and turn to the sixth chapter of the Gospel according to John. The sixth chapter of the Gospel according to St. John. This is our 25th Sunday in this book. If you don't have a field journal yet, it's a Gospel of John with journal pages, every other page of Scripture. We have those for you. If you would like a free John journal, just raise your hand, hold it up, and be patient. We got some fellows that are going to walk it to you to give it to you. So just if you want one, hold your hand, and you will get one. As you find your place there in John chapter 6, we're going to be having our 15th birthday celebration as a church next Sunday, one service, 10 a.m. right here. We're also going to have a baptism. If you want to be part of that baptism, if you want to be baptized, have questions about that, we would love to walk with you through what that looks like. Just let me know. I'll be hanging out up here. Pastor Derek will be over here afterwards as well. You can also email me. My email is on the back of the bulletin that you were given when you came in, and we'd love to work out that for you to be baptized next Sunday. And then we're going to go over to the park. We've got a lot of games, bounce houses, a dunking booth where you can dunk me and Pastor Derek and Pastor Dave and many others in the water. It'd be nice. But we're going to have a good time. Free food and everything like that. So make plans to be here. Come in your park clothes and bring park games and everything like that. And also on October 19th, it's a Saturday, 8:30 a.m. We'll be having all the single ladies here of the Axis Church. Those who aren't married yet. We're going to have a breakfast together. Want to ask you some questions. Would love for you to bring some friends as well. Want to encourage you. So if you're not married, if you're single, I would love to spend that Saturday morning with you. Please make plans to be here for that. All right, so some context for where we are in John 6. It's a dense chapter. It's a lengthy chapter, 71 verses. Earlier in chapter 6, a big crowd forms around Jesus. He has compassion on them all day, serves them. It gets late in the day, they get hungry, the disciples want to send them away. Jesus said, let's not send them away, let's feed them instead. He takes a little bit of fish, a little bit of bread, some barley cakes, multiplies it, feeds 5,000 men, not counting women and children. 20, 25,000 people get fed from just a little boy's lunch. Well, the crowd loves this. And they start following him. Jesus points out that they want to follow him because of what he does for them physically, not for what his actual salvific mission actually was, which is to be the Messiah who would suffer and die for his people, not a political king who would reign to power 2,000 years ago, but one who would die 2,000 years ago to reign eternally into the millions of years into eternity future. Well, the crowd is not dismissed. The crowd does not listen to Jesus and go home. They continue pursuing him, even pursuing him by boat. And that's where they find Jesus in our context is in Capernaum after they chased him down across the waters. He's in a synagogue and he's teaching. He's dialoguing back and forth as a rabbi often would in the synagogue. So he's there in Capernaum, and that's where a lot of this dialogue in John 6 comes from. It's part of this sermon that he says in John 6, I'm the bread of life. I'm the one who satisfies from a spiritual standpoint. I ultimately, everlastingly can give you what your heart is longing for. Just like you look for in food physically, I can give your spirit this eternally, spiritually, forever and ever. Just the day before, the crowd had Jesus satisfy their physical hunger, and now they're back for more. And Jesus says, you don't need the bread that perishes. You don't need another meal. You've got places for that. I've come that you might have life, eternal life, and I'm the only source of this life, and that is why I'm here. You need me as you face death. You've got bread to face hunger. You need me as you face eternity. So he teaches, he just has taught about being the bread of life and the necessity even of eating his flesh and drinking his blood, and it's a hard saying. Many of his disciples found this hard to accept. Which brings up a few questions. I want you to think about this personally. What do you do when the teachings of Jesus Christ challenge your understanding, your comfort, your thoughts. Why do you think some people walk away from Jesus when his message is difficult to hear? Much like the crowd, I want to ask you, are you following Jesus for who he truly is, or just for what he can do for you in this lifetime? As you consider the many teachings of Jesus, you might know few, you might know several, but when you think about the teachings of Jesus, what's the most challenging teaching of Jesus that you have come across? Like as you read scripture, what sticks out as something you don't like, but it's there? What comes to mind? Why do you think some people walk away from the Christian faith while others persevere, like even through great difficulty and trials and struggles? How do you think of that? How do you rectify that? What does it mean to truly follow Jesus in a world that rejects certain truths, particularly those that rub up against the culture's definition of truth? What does it mean to truly follow Jesus when culture is so set against a lot of what he demands? This passage that we have before us, it puts a question before us, among many. But the essence is, what do you do when following Jesus and his teachings is tough? Let's jump into John chapter 6, starting in verse 60. When many of his disciples heard this teaching, they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? Who can absorb it? Who can really understand it? Who can follow it?" But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, "Do you take offense at this?" So Jesus just said some tough words, right? And the crowd, the big crowd disputes, they argue. Remember last week, we looked at this, they were arguing and grumbling kind of under their breath about the teachings of Jesus, but so were his disciples. It wasn't just the crowd, it was the large crowd of his disciples. He had many more than just 12 disciples. He had hundreds of followers. And then he had thousands of those who weren't followers, but were following because they were entertained. Hence the crowd, right? From Tiberias and from Galilee that have been following him. And Jesus knows his disciples, among others, are grumbling about his teaching. Remember what he said in Matthew 11, 6. "Blessed are those who are not offended by me and my message and my words." Blessed is the one who is not offended by me. Like the gospel message, the core of Christianity, that Jesus died on the cross to forgive you of your sin, to save you back to God, to rescue you from hell and give you eternity in heaven. This gospel message offends many people. And that should break our hearts towards prayer, not pride. As the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:18, "For the word of the cross," the gospel, "the word of the cross is foolishness, it's folly to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Again, blessed are those who are not offended by this gospel message. Like Paul says in Romans 1:16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes." The gospel message is life-giving for those who believe. The gospel is life-giving for those who believe. And so some hear it, and much like in our text, they don't believe. Instead, they mumble, they murmur, they dispute. Again, even some of his disciples are doing this. And Jesus knew what they were mumbling about. He knew what they were thinking. So he asked, "Do you take offense at this?" Look at verse 62. "Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending back into heaven where he was before?" Which is going to happen later on after his resurrection. This has already taken place. Jesus essentially says, and he challenges this group of disciples, basically asking if his coming ascension is going to shock them more than what he's currently teaching. In other words, if this is difficult, what are you going to do when you see me ascending, like floating up into the heavens? He continues teaching the disciples in verse 63, powerful verse. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is no, I don't know what's going on here. Pull it away. All right, need to trim the beard. Okay. He continues teaching the disciples. He says, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is no help at all. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Jesus point blank gets at the root of us being able to understand him and his teaching. Essentially, he says the flesh, the natural man, isn't helpful when trying to understand, when trying to find true life. It is only the work of the Holy Spirit. It is only the Holy Spirit who can give life. Not only this, he goes on to say that my teaching, my words, they are spirit and they are life if you would just believe. If you would just believe, there's spirit and life. Verse 64, but there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus' context, John, the author, lets us know, for Jesus knew from the beginning those who did not believe and who it was who would betray him, those who would not believe. My teaching, my words, they are spirit and they are life. If you would but believe, however, not all of you believe. See, Jesus knew about many that would betray him. Particularly, he knew the one about Judas, who would not merely turn on him, but as we'll see later, who would turn him in. Again, 63, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no help at all. 65, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is no help at all. This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. Giving spiritual life, this is nothing you can do. The flesh, the natural man, that's of no help at all. That's why I said what I did earlier, that no one can come to me unless that desire is given to him by my Father. True saving faith is not an intellectual assent. It is the work of the Holy Spirit of God in the heart of dead mankind. Human effort cannot produce saving faith. The late R.C. Sproul said, faith is not something that can be conjured up by human will. It is something that God gives through his Spirit. And the Apostle Paul writes of this in 1 Corinthians 2:14, the natural person in the flesh, not the Spirit, the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. They are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they're spiritually discerned. The natural man, in his spiritually dead state, he's unable and incapable to accept spiritual truths without the presence, activity, and power of the Holy Spirit of God. That's why Paul wrote in Romans 8:7, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It's hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's will. Indeed, it cannot. It cannot submit to God's will. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. It's impossible. In order to please God, in order to submit to him, you have to have something more than your mortal, fallen, sinful nature, your flesh. You must have the Spirit of God living within you. The Spirit of God comes upon and within a person when God sovereignly chooses to allow that to happen. You see, the flesh, the natural man, can't grasp or accept the things of God. As Jesus said, only the Spirit gives life. Echoing what Philippians 2:13 says, it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The late Bishop J.C. Ryle said, Christ is the source of all true spiritual life. If we would be saved, we must come to him. We must feed upon him and believe in him, or we shall never find peace for our souls. Jesus essentially says this, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, unless this abiding is there. He teaches this, and essentially the result happens in verse 66. After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. You see, he had more than just the 12. Many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. And have you ever felt abandoned? Like, do you fear it? Do you struggle with abandonment issues? Often it's triggered from something in our past, in our background, in our childhood. That really bothers me. It's one of the things that bothers me most, personally, being honest with you. But it's also one of the very things that Jesus experienced personally himself. Many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. Look at how he responds. Perhaps his humanity speaks here as well. He said to the 12, "Do you want to go away too?" What a question, man. Maybe this is Jesus experiencing abandonment and sadness, and he asks his closest friends and followers if they're going to leave him as well. Or maybe Jesus asked this to have his disciples think over the commitment needed to continue following. Are you guys going to leave too, or are y'all in? And this is appropriate release from following me. It's an exit ramp opportunity. There's many who are no longer following. You want to join them, or are you with me? Whatever the case is, many disciples turn back and they no longer follow Jesus because they cannot accept his teaching. This is a warning of apostasy. Apostasy is rejecting Jesus, rejecting the Holy Scriptures. Apostasy reveals that not all who follow Jesus for a season truly believe. And the superficiality of their faith is exposed, it's proven when faced with difficult truths, circumstances, and teaching. 1 John 2:19 speaks of this. "They went out from us because they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain, that it might be proven that they all are not of us." The departure of some, this reveals that they were never truly part of Christ's people. So how can you make sure you don't drift or turn apostate? You repent often. You pray for mercy, and you pray for mercy, and you pray for mercy. And you pursue Jesus Christ and Christ's likeness like your eternal life depends on it, because in some ways it does. This is why the author of Hebrews writes in Hebrews 3:12, "Take care, brothers." He's writing to Christians. "Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God." How do we fight this? You exhort one another. This proves the power of team, of unity, of church family, of community. Do not live in isolation as a Christian. It is dangerous. You'll turn wolf or you'll become wolf food. That's what a sheep alone is. Exhort one another every day, as long as it's today, that none of you may be hardened. This is a process. That none of you may become hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. There's a drift to where you're deceitfully led off into sin, for we have come to share in Christ if we indeed hold our original confidence firm, hold firm to the end. Charles Spurgeon said, "A faith that can be destroyed was never real in the first place. True faith endures because it is anchored in the promises and person of Christ, not in your preferences, not in your pleasure, but in the promises and person of Jesus Christ." Remember the parable of the sower, some on the path, the rocky soil, the fertile ground, and so forth? Jesus warned of superficial faith in the parable of the sower in Luke chapter 8. The ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the gospel, they hear the word, they receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing, trials, teachings, tough circumstances, in time of testing, they fall away. Well, Jesus tests the crowd here. He tests the disciples with his message, and the result is many stop following him. So he turns to the 12, ask if they would stop following him. Are you in or are you out? And the spokesman of the disciples, the older disciple, Peter, he responds on behalf of the disciples, like was his role. He answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. What an answer. Actually, it's a question. It's a question. Are you going to go as well? To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Remember what Jesus said in verse 63, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. So within the answer that Peter gives, he displays faith in what Jesus just taught. The words that I've spoken to you are spirit and life. And then Peter, he says, the words that you have are words of eternal life. Again, Simon Peter in 68, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have believed. We have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. With my heart, I believe. With my mind, I know that you are the Holy One of God. You see, true disciples, true Christians, they cling to Christ when it's difficult. They cling to Christ when life is full of challenge and trial. They cling and they follow. They continue to abide as they were abiding before the trial because they truly believe that only Jesus has the words of life. Again, Peter says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed, we've come to know that you are the Holy One of God. This is similar to the confession that Peter gives in Matthew 16. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. This echoes the Apostle Paul's sentiment in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 8. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things. I count them actually as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes through obedience to the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and that I might share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain to the resurrection from the dead, that I might live with him forever. Once more, 68 and 69, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed it. We've come to know it, that you are the Holy One of God. Man, this is beautiful. This is such a beautiful response. Yet, the we that Peter speaks of, not all of the we agree with what Peter said. And Jesus knows this. Remember back in 64, there were some of you who do not believe, for Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was who would betray him. So Jesus responds back to Peter and a group in verse 70. Did I not choose you, the 12, and yet one of you is a devil? He spoke of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, for he, one of the 12, not the greater crowd of disciples, one of the 12, was going to betray him. Now imagine not having read the New Testament, and you get the book of John, and you get to this portion, you're thinking, man, Jesus is phenomenal. This teaching stuff, man, what a guy. And his disciples, man, they're just right there with him. And then you come to this verse, not knowing how this is going to play out, and you read that one of the 12 is going to betray him. One of the 12, not one of the other disciples from the larger group of the followers, one of the 12, Judas, the one responsible for keeping up the money of the disciples. You know, Judas is proof that just by connecting yourself with strong Christian leadership, a strong gospel-centered church, a healthy and strong discipleship program, none of that makes you a Christian. Who discipled you? Jesus. Oh, you're good then. No, uh-uh. In some ways, it's more than who your leader is. It's what you're doing with your leader and for your leader. And it's more than what you think you believe about him. I often hear, I need more discipleship. Okay, maybe, but Judas had the best. I mean, it could be that you should do more with what you already have. That was the problem with Judas. It's often my problem. And if you'd be honest, it's probably part of yours. I mean, Judas serves as a sobering reminder that it's possible to be close to Jesus physically, to do life on life with him for 3.5 years, and yet be far from him spiritually, completely severed and disconnected from him. What this means in part is that being part of a local church doesn't make you a Christian any more than walking to a cornfield makes you a cornstalk. But we believe it does. A lot of us have faith that by showing up to a church gathering on a Sunday makes us good with God. That is a lie. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, when I return and judge humanity, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, do we not prophesy, preach, declare your gospel in your name? Did we not do miraculous things like cast out demonic spirits in your name? Did we not do mighty works and miracles in your name? And he will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Lawlessness, we prophesied in your name. We taught, we discipled. We cast out demons. We performed miracles in your name. Lawlessness. It's not what we do. It's the heart. Depart from me. I never knew you. And you never knew me. You knew religion. Showing up at church, taking communion, giving money to the church, learning about Jesus, serving Jesus and the church. None of this makes you a Christian. This is Judas's resume. He serves as an example of this reality. He was close to Jesus, but spiritually he was distant. He gives us as he serves us as an example. Do you see it? And what are you doing with this example? May we all do as 2 Corinthians 13:5 encourages us to do, examine yourself to see whether you're in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you unless you indeed fail to meet the test? Again, J.C. Ryle serves us here. He says, let us often examine ourselves whether we be in the faith. Let us see that we really trust in Christ and not in our own fancied good deeds or outward forms. You know, there's a cost to following Jesus Christ. And I know for a lot of you, I'm not sure what you were told when you came to faith in Christ Jesus. I'm not sure what you were promised, what you were sold, if you will, when you decided to step into the Christian faith. And so this might come as a surprise for some of you, but the truth about Christianity is it's difficult to follow Jesus Christ. As Jesus said in Luke 14:27, whoever does not bear his own cross, that's difficult. And come after me cannot be my disciple. Christian discipleship is not a program of the church. It's a way of life. It is a pattern. It is a way. It is a path that follows Jesus. And Christian discipleship requires that you accept difficult teachings and you follow Jesus even when it involves hardships and difficulties, especially when there's hardships, difficulties, struggles, and challenges. That's part of what's going on in our text today. I mean, many people follow Jesus when he performs miracles, but when he begins to make demands of them, they leave him. John Stott says, there's nothing new about a Christianity that does nothing, that costs nothing, that suffers nothing. There's nothing new about that. What is new and deadly is a widespread notion that one can be a Christian without being a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christianity is more than a religion. It has religious components to it, no doubt, as it should, as it must. But at the heart of Christianity is not a list of things to do. At the heart of Christianity is a person. And true Christianity is lived out by faith as you follow that person. You wrap your whole life, your whole being around that one person. You submit everything to that one person, and that one person tells you to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow him in humble obedience, no matter what it may cost you. And that one person is Jesus Christ, the God-man, the Son of God, Son of Man, the Savior of mankind, the Lord of all creation. And following him will cost you something. It costs you everything in some ways. And it's challenging, and it's sanctifying, and it's life-changing. It's a narrow path with few friends. As Matthew 7 tells us, Jesus mentions this. You will be judged. You will be misunderstood. I mean, look at the leader of the Christian movement. It's Jesus. He was despised and rejected, betrayed, and misunderstood. Why would it be different for his followers? Look at the disciples. They were all martyred except one. He was exiled and tortured on an island by himself. Christianity is difficult, but Jesus is with you to the very end. And the Holy Spirit is within you, comforting you, strengthening you, guiding you, befriending you along the way. True Christian living is not merely established on faith. It requires faith of you in every single moment of your life. True faith is a fight for constant faith. Faith is essential. And there's plenty of warnings about superficial, shallow, phony faith. And there is a danger in a belief that is not anchored and rooted in Christ, a faith that isn't being watered each day in consistent prayer and Bible reading, leaning on the Christian community for inspiration, motivation, encouragement, to tell you in times of difficulty to not give up, to not tap out, to not slow down, to not take the bait of temptation, to not grow weary, to not give in, but instead you carry on, you dig deep, you collapse forward towards the cross every day, and you lift your eyes to the Lord where you see him high and lifted up, sitting on the throne of the universe, so that even in the midst of loss and challenge and suffering, as you walk the difficult path of following the greatest rabbi of all time, you are comforted and energized as you see that evil is on a leash and Satan has to beg permission, and you realize that all things truly work together for the good of those who are called by God and who love him. That is Christianity. What have you signed up for? If it's not this, make it this and live for something that's worth sacrificing for, something worth suffering for, something worth dying for. That, my friend, is Christianity. Following Jesus with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, with all of it, with all of it, and loving other people, even your enemies, as yourself. Christianity is sacrificing and suffering for and being willing to die for Jesus Christ. And so I ask you again, what have you signed up for? And don't follow like Judas did. Don't follow like those who turned away when it got challenging and difficult and rubbed up against what they felt like should be true. Follow with the utter dependence of the 11 disciples and thousands of others throughout Christian history who chose to deny themselves, take up their crosses daily, and follow Jesus. There is a cost to following Jesus. The gospel calls us to follow him even when his words challenge us, and true disciples endure while others fall away. But what about you? Will you follow Jesus for who he truly is? Even when it's difficult, even when it's challenging, or like many, many hundreds of people in this passage today, will you do like them and walk away? The fact is, there's been many people sit where you're sitting in this very room, and there's been men preach from this podium. There's been musicians play on this stage, and there's been people give money and serve here at the church. There's been so many people raise their hands in song, many people who just like you, and yet they've walked away. Oh,
They've walked away from Jesus. God, have mercy. They've walked away from the Christian church. They've walked away from humbling themselves to Scripture. I can see their faces. It bothers me, and I fear it for you. You're getting so pulled by culture. You're getting so pulled through so many other truths, and you're taking the bait, and it's the slow, deceitful drift of sin. I mean, like, what is it about your pursuit that gives you hope that you'll be any different? How do you know that you won't make shipwreck of your faith? I can promise you that placing culture's definition of truth over the Word of God will shipwreck your faith. That you living in isolation and being slow to repent and not walking in confession and Christian community, that's a fast track to this. I've seen it happen so many times. So what is it about your Christian walk that gives you an assurance that you're on the path that leads to life? Yes, doctrinally, I know the Lord gives you strength to persevere, but doctrinally, I know that you've got to put forth effort and time, and you've got to lean and depend on that strength. Lasting to the end doesn't just happen. There's a synergistic working that leads you to lasting, that leads you to enduring. The indwelling Holy Spirit and your willingness to humbly obey Him, to trust Him and follow Him, sacrificing everything to follow Him. This is Christianity. This is the walk of repentance. It's constantly pulling yourself back to the narrow path. You're failing. You fall. You trip. It's clumsy and ugly. But you get up and you continue onward towards Jesus. You continue onward towards the cross. It's not easy. There's a natural path, a wide path that leads to pleasure that kills you in the end. You want life at the end? Then you die today. You die to yourself. You die to your pride and your arrogance. Oh, I know the truth, and this doesn't really mean it. Humble yourself for the sake of your eternal soul. Humble yourself to the Word and believe it by faith. You want to do what feels best, what's easiest? You'll die in the end. Stop playing games with the Christian religion. Stop playing games with your Christian walk. It's not a game. It's life or death. And don't walk away. Please, don't walk. Where will you turn if not to Jesus? Who else can give you the words of life and back it up every time, delivering on His promises? Don't walk away. Lean into the struggle of faith. Lean in to trust Him. You may not believe yet, but don't stop thinking. Don't stop pursuing. And if this is tough for you, keep praying, keep reading, keep digging and investigating. Do not turn away here. You come to Him, He'll never send you away. One of our favorite passages here at the Axis is this: come to Me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take My yoke upon you. Learn from Me. I'm gentle, I'm lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For My yoke is easy, and My burden is light. Well, did you know that religion invites you to rest as well? It's a fake rest, but it sounds good. They promise the same thing. Religion says, come to Me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will add to your work. I'll make it more difficult for you. Take My yoke upon you. Perform for Me. I'm harsh and I'm proud. And so long as you work hard enough, I might give you what you're looking for. We'll have to see. For My yoke is impossible and My burden is overwhelming. Friend, Jesus came to earth 2,000 years ago to perform for you, to fulfill every single requirement of the law as you and for you. and by faith in that work, believing that he did in fact do that for you, you are accredited his perfect righteousness as he suffered on the cross for your imperfect sinfulness. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. It's by his wounds that you've been healed. And by faith in this, by true faith in this, believing that Jesus did this for you, you can fearlessly live big for him, pursuing him imperfectly, but pursuing him relentlessly nonetheless. And by faith in this, because Jesus actually did this for you, with joy, Jesus calls to you, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. That's an invitation to a life of pursuit. I'm gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. For those of us in this room who are Christians, those who have taken this invitation to come to Christ and find life and rest, those who are pursuing Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord, it is with joy that I invite you to the Lord's table, where you are told to remember the work of Jesus. So as you come and take, we'll have four servers across the front. As you come and take, remember Christ and consider your walk today, Christian. Consider your walk. Examine yourselves, test yourselves, as we're told. And for those who aren't Christians, or perhaps you realize today that you've placed your faith, what you thought was in the Christian faith, you have placed it in something other than Christ, I invite you to pursue Jesus Christ and take him by faith and be made a Christian. Let's pray together for this time. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, and we proclaim the mystery of the Christian faith, that Christ has come. He's lived. He's died, and he's risen. He's ascended into heaven. And he will come again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of communion and remain with us always. Amen. Christian, you can come when you're ready.